Yes, sir.
Yeah.
Hello, everyone.
Today I'll be presenting.
Today I'll be presenting on Ravi Verma. Raja Ravi Verma was one of the Indian painter and an artist. He is considered among the greatest painters in the history of Indian art. He was born on April 29, 1848. Raja Ravi Verma was born in the royal palace of Kilamunu, Kerala. His parents were Umbanda Thampurathi and Neelakandan Bhatirapad. At the age of 7 years, he started drawing on the palace walls using charcoal. At the age of 14, Ayilam Tirunal Maharaj took him to the Transport Palace and he was taught watercolor painting by the palace painter Ramaswamy Naidu. He was later given lessons in oil painting by a British painter, Tudor Jensen. In 1873, Ravi Verma won the first at the Madras Painting Exhibition. He achieved worldwide acclaim. He won an award for an exhibition of his paintings when also sent the World's Columbian Exposition held in Chicago. In 1893, he was awarded 3 gold medals. In 1904, Viceroy Lord Curzon, on behalf of the British King Emperor, awarded him the Kaiser I Hind medal, gold medal. Raja Ravi Verma was one of the greatest painters in the history of Bharatiya art. Ravi Verma is particularly noted for his painting of stories on Dushyanta, Shakuntala, Nala, Damayanti from Mahabharata. Many of his fabulous paintings are housed at Lakshmi Vilas Palace, Godhara. Raja Ravi Verma was fascinated of the power and forceful expression of European paintings, which came across them strikingly contrasting to stylish or artwork. His paintings are considered to be among the best examples of fusion of Bharatiya traditions with techniques of European art. Ravi Verma is most remembered for his paintings of beautiful sari-clad women who were portrayed as very shapeful and graceful. Ravi Verma is believed to have made around 7,000 paintings. Raja Ravi Verma is also known as father of modern Indian art. Raja Ravi Verma remembered for giving Indians their Western classical representations of Hindu gods and goddesses. He was an 18th century painter who attained fame and recognition for portraying scenes from epics of Mahabharata and Ramayana. He died on 2nd October 1906. Thank you.
Thank you, Jayapriya. Good presentation, Ravi Verma. Let's move on to the next presentation by Sampada. Sampada will present on Chandragupta. How is it? Okay, fine. So then I will record it sometime later today. Then I will ask you to present. Okay, I'll let you know on that. Okay, so we'll move to the next presentation by Sachit. Sachit will present on Vikramaditya.
Yes, sir.
Okay.
Sir, can you see, sir?
Yeah, I can see.
Namaste to everyone. Today I'll be presenting on theme Vikramaditya. Introduction. Vikramaditya was a legendary emperor of ancient India. He was often characterized as an ideal king. He is known for his generosity, courage, and patronage for scholars. Vikramaditya is featured in hundreds of traditional Indian stories, including those in Baital Pachisi, which is nothing but Vikramaditya and Baital, and Singhasan Pachisi, which is a story about King Vikramaditya's throne. Many describe him as a universal ruler with his capital as Ujjain. According to popular tradition, Vikramaditya began the Vikram Samvat era in 57 BCE after defeating the Shakas, and those who believe that he is based on a historical figure place him around the 1st century BCE. However, this era is identified as Vikram Sampat after the 9th century CE. Other scholars believe that Vikramaditya is a mythical character, since several legends of him are fantastic in nature, this Betal could not be a real person. King Vikram and Betal. The legendary King Vikramaditya promises a Vamachari, who is a tantric sage, that he will capture a Vetala, a celestial spirit Pishachi, who hangs upside down from a tree and inhabits and animates dead bodies. King Vikram faces many difficulties in bringing the Vetala to the tantric. Each time Vikram tries to capture the Vetala, it will tell a story that ends with a riddle. If Vikramaditya cannot answer the question correctly, the vampire will come and remain in captivity. The king knows the answer, but still keeps quiet, then his head shall burst into 1,000 pieces. If King Vikram will answer the question correctly, then the vampire would escape and return to his tree. He knows the answer to every question, therefore the cycle of capturing and releasing the vampire continues 24 times. But at last, the Vetala will stump the king with his 25th question. And in the end, Vetala will come with the king. Singhasan Bhattisi. Singhasan Bhattisi is a collection of Indian folk tales. The title literally means 32 tales of the throne. In the frame story, the 11th century king Boja discovers the throne of the legendary ancient king Vikramaditya in a field of a farmer. The throne has 32 statues sculpted on it, who are actually apsaras that has been turned into stone due to a curse by Parvati. Each of the apsara tells Boja a story about the lives and adventures of Vikramaditya. In order to convince Boja that he is not deserving of Vikramaditya's throne, as he is not just like Vikramaditya and does not actually like favor his subjects due to their richness. Dhanyavad.
Thank you, Sachit. That Simhasana Bhattisi, which Sachit mentioned, was part of our school studies. I remember that story completely. Is it still there? Anyone is it part of any of your textbooks?
No, sir.
No, okay, fine. So we'll move to the next presentation by Dhriti. Dhriti has joined now. Dhriti will present.
Yes, sir.
Yeah, go ahead.
One second, sir.
Okay.
Yes, sir.
Yeah, we can see now.
Namaste. I'm going to press. He is dated between 1500 BCE and 1400 CE. He was an ancient India theatrologist and a musicologist who wrote Natya Shastra, which is a theatrical written work dealing formally and systematically with a subject, especially Sanskrit theatre. He is considered the father of Indian theatrical art forms. Natya Shastra. Natya Shastra is a Sanskrit treatise on performing arts. The text is attributed to sage Bharat Muni. The text consists of 36 chapters with a cumulative total of 6,000 poetic verses describing performance arts. The subject covered by the treatise included dramatic composition, structure of a play, body movement, makeups and costumes, role and goals of an art director, the musical scale, musical instruments, and the integration of music with art performance. Aim of Natya Shastra. Natya Shastra is ultimately to let the spectator experience his own consciousness, then evaluate and feel the spiritual value innate in him and rise to a higher level of consciousness. It gives us four different types of Natya or acting: the graceful, energetic, verbal, and the grand. Abhinav Bharati. Bharatmuni further inspired secondary literature called Abhinav Bharati. It's an example of classic Sanskrit Bhashya, which was written in Sanskrit. Thank you.
Thank you, Dhruti. So a lot of us wouldn't have heard about Bharatmuni and his contribution to the dance forms. Thank you for that. Move on to the next presentation for today. The next presentation is from Suresh. Suresh will present on Samudragupta.
Yes. Okay, so hi, I'm Suyash, and today I'll be presenting on Samudragupta. Can you see my screen? So who was Samudragupta? Samudragupta was the son of King Chandragupta I and the princess Kumara Devi. At the time of his accession, the political condition of the country was unstable and uncertain. Samudragupta brought stability and ensured conducive atmosphere against all odds. He gave respite to the people and brought peace and prosperity. The small empire founded by Chandragupta I was stretched to a gigantic shape and stepped up to the height of its glory by him. Undisputedly, he conquered state after state and extended his empire. His performance of Ashwamedha Yajna confirms his military supremacy over the other rulers. He was no doubt a military genius, but he was equally a successful diplomat. His policy of conquest and liberal attitude towards the defeated kings highlights his diplomatic skill and shrewdness. So you can see like how far the Gupta Empire stretched. He conquered all of Ayodhya, Mathura, Avadh, the Lichavis, everything. So his reign. He never followed the policy of reckless warfare. He knew where to stop and how to gain the allegiance of his vanquished opponents. His diplomatic triumph opened new ways of cementing friendliness with the foreign rulers externally and many opponent kings internally. Samudragupta was a highly capable and efficient administrator. He organized civil administration in a systematic way that ensured peace and prosperity throughout the vast empire. He reformed the official system by bringing officials into his control. This system virtually continued to exist till his final conquest of northern Bharat by the Muslims. Samudragupta was the emperor from about 330 to 380 CE. He was generally considered as the epitome of an ideal king of the golden age of Hindu history, as the period of the imperial Guptas 320 to 510 CE has often been called. As a person, Samudragupta had a great attachment to art, literature, and learning. He composed many poems in Sanskrit and earned the title of Kaviraj, the king of the poets. Many eminent scholars adorned his court and enhanced prestige and dignity. He was also a man of musical arts. In some of his coins, he is shown as seated on a couch and playing a veena or lute as a musician. His court poets have extolled his polished intellect, poetic skill, and proficiency in music. Samudragupta was also a philosopher. Thank you.
Okay. So I had a confusion, or many of us had a confusion about being a Chandragupta. The Chandragupta comes in Gupta dynasty as well as in Maurya dynasty.
That's Chandragupta. One is like his name is Chandragupta, not Chandragupta. Maurya. It's a different Chandragupta. Yeah.
Correct. So that clarity is required from every one of us.
Yeah.
So the Samudragupta is in part of the Gupta dynasty. Yes. Yeah. And the one we hear about Chanakya and Ashoka is from the Mauryan dynasty. So these two Chandraguptas are two different, and we have to be distinguishing between them. Thank you, Suresh. So we'll move to the next presentation by Harish Krishna. He will present on Harshavardhana. Harish Krishna.
Yes, sir. Just give me 1 second, sir.
Yeah. Sure.
Yes, sir. Namaste all. Welcome. Today I'm going to be presenting on Harshavardhana. Harshavardhana was an important king during the 7th century. King Harshavardhana was born during the time of 590 BCE to 647 BCE. His land extended from North Bharat to the Narmada River in Central Bharat. He was a descendant of the Pushyabhuti dynasty. His reign ended after he was defeated by Pulakesi II. This was the territory of Harshavardhana. It's extremely massive. King Harshavardhana's kindness towards his people. King Harshavardhana always had empathy for the poor. King Harshavardhana's dynasty administration system and the Gupta dynasty have similar systems. In Harshavardhana's kingdom, there was no slavery. People were allowed to live the life they chose. For example, if one wanted to be a fisherman, they could be a fisherman. Because in those days, if your father was a carpenter, for example, you would also have to become a carpenter. But in Harshavardhana's kingdom, there was no such rule like that. And he had a huge empathy for the poor. He built rest homes for the poor, built with all amenities such as water, food, beds, etc. Harshavardhana at his time had the strongest army. He had a cavalry of 100,000 or 1 lakh, and he had 50,000 infantry or warriors at this time, and he had 60,000 elephants, which was an extremely massive army. Conclusion. Harshavardhana was a powerful king of his time. He had a kind heart and loved helping people in need. He also had the love for education. Dhanyavad.
Thank you, Harish Krishna. The good information about Harshavardhana. So when we hear about Harshavardhana, Harshavardhana was ruling in the north part of India, while the south part we had Imadi Pulakeshi. So they were the contemporaries. So when we hear about one, we can remember the other person. Both were great personalities, part of our India. So we'll move to the next presentation from Vaividhya. Vaividhya will present on King Shailendra.
Yes, sir.
Yeah, go ahead.
Sir, actually, I'm not able to share, so can I do it in the next class?
Yeah, fine, Vaidya, no problem. So we'll move to the next presentation. Bhargav, are you ready with your presentation? Bhargav, can't hear you.
Sir, I'm not prepared the presentation.
Okay. So, Shraddha, are you ready with the presentation?
Yes, sir.
Yeah, go ahead.
Is it visible?
Yes.
Good morning, everyone. Today I'm going to be talking about the great personalities of Sayanacharya and Madhvacharya. Sayanacharya was a great Vedic and Sanskrit scholar who lived during the reign of Vijayanagara kings. His commentaries and works have been the foundation for many translations of Vedas as of today. Early Indologists, including Max Müller, extensively referred to his bhashyas or commentaries on the four Vedas. Sayanacharya occupies a unique place in the history of Sanskrit literature. The learned commentaries written by him on the Vedic Samhitas and Brahmanas are the most important works of their kind, which are of immense value to us. Sayanacharya, along with his elder brother Madhvacharya, were the proponents of Vedic learning under the rule of early Vijayanagara monarchs. Sayanacharya was born in a learned South Indian Brahmana family. His father was a Mayana and his mother a Srimati. He was a Brahmana of the Bharadwaja Gotra, Bodhayana Sutra and Krishna Yajurveda. He belonged to the Taittiriya Sakha of the Krishna Yajurveda, as is also evident from the fact that the very first Vedic commentary he wrote was on the Taittiriya Samhita of the Krishna Yajurveda. He had two brothers, Madhvacharya and Bhogunatha, of whom the first was the eldest and the second was the youngest of the three. The Vedic commentaries are monuments of vast and varied learned bhashas on the Taittiriya Samhita and rightly occupy the foremost place in the writings of Shainacharya. Shaina was entrusted with the composition of Vedic commentaries by King Bukka on the recommendation of his elder brother Madhava, who as the Adhyatmic Guru was actually requested by the king for this responsible task, but who presumably, owing to his multifarious engagements in other spheres, declined this offer in favor of his younger brother. Thus it was under the inspiring guidance of Madhva that Shaina wrote his learned commentaries on the Veda, which he rightly called Madhviya after his elder brother to express his gratitude. Madhvacharya. The elder brother Madhvacharya occupies a very important place in the history of Dharma Shastra and Mimamsa literature. Besides being well-versed in various branches of learning, he was a great minister of the first Vijayanagara kings, Harihara and Bukka, who with his sages' counsel and judicious guidance founded the ideal Hindu Raja, that never-to-be-forgotten empire of Vijayanagara. He is also credited on the authority of eminent historians with the foundation of the city of Vijayanagara. Both Madhvacharya and Shainacharya said to have studied under Vidyatheta of Sringeri and held offices in the Vijayanagara Empire. Madhava gave the responsibility of writing the Bhashyas on the Taittiriya Samhita ordered by King Bukka to his brother, as he was engaged in multiple other activities. In his honor, it was named Madhviya. The king built a magnificent temple in Vijayanagara in honor of the Saint Madhvacharya. There is a small village and inmates around the famous temple of Hampi, which still stands on the banks of the river today. Thank you.
Thank you, Shraddha. So the brothers, Shainacharya and Madhvacharya. So there is one more personality with the same name, Madhvacharya, on which Sampada presented 2 weeks back. So you have to differentiate between these two personalities. So the one is Madhvacharya, which is Ma only, and the one which presented now is Madhvacharya. So those are two different personalities and two different ages of their existence. Thank you, Shraddha. So we'll move to the next presentation for the day. So Pranav, are you ready with your presentation? I think Pranav is not there. So Rupesh, is he there? Not there, Avekta and Vaishnavi are not there. Fine, Sampada. Then I will start the recording. You can present now. Sampada, you stop the recording and present. Okay, fine. Then no problem. So we have covered. We tried to reach out all of you, and that is what is planned today. I have not prepared anything, so I thought your presentation will cover for a complete day. Okay, so we'll just have some recall on the shlokas that we have covered till now. Give me a minute, so we'll revise the shlokas that we have covered till now. Just present some of them so that you can read and we can listen to them. Okay, I will be presenting. Okay. Can you see my screen?
Yes, sir.
Can one of you read this? Bhargav, can you read it?
Yes. Arundhatyava Suryacha Savitri Jati Siti Draupadi Karna Gita Veera Durga Vidita
Arundhatyana Suryacha Savitri Janaki Sati Draupadi Kannagi Gargi Meera Durgavati Tatha.
Who can read the Kannada fluently? Dhruti, can you try?
Yes, sir. Lakshmi Rahalya Channamma Rudra Mambasu Vikrama Nivedita Saradacha Pranamya Matri Devataha.
Lakshmi Rahalya Channamma Rudra Mambasu Vikrama Nivedita Saradacha Pranamya Matri Devataha.
So the next one. Mrunal, can you read it?
Yes, sir. Shri Ramo Bharata Krishno Bhishmo Dharmasthatharjunaha Markandeya Harishchandro Prahalada Narado Dhruvaha.
Shri Ramo Bharata Krishno Bhishmo Dharmasthatharjunaha Markandeyo Harishchandra Prahalado Narado Dhruvaha.
Sanvi, can you read it?
Yes, sir.
Yeah.
Hanuman Janako Vyaso Vashishtashchashuko Balihi Dadichi Vishwakarmano Prithuvamiki Bhargavaha.
Hanuman Janako Vyaso Vashishtashchashuko Balihi Dadichi Vishwakarmano Prithuvamiki Bhargavaha.
Okay, so these were the lokas. So we'll move to next one. Okay. Chit, can you read it?
Sir, I'll read the both of them, sir.
Okay, fine, go ahead.
Bhakshiratashchai kalavyo manur dhanvantaristatha Shibishcharanti devascha purana puranod gita kirtayaha.
Bhakshiratashchai kalavyo manur dhanvantaristatha Shivishcharanti devascha purano udgita kirtayah.
Who can read this? Shusti, can you read it?
Yes, sir. Buddha Jinendra Gorakshaha Pani Nishcha Patanjalihi Shankaro Madhva Nimbakao Shri Ramanuja Vallabhau.
Buddha Jinendra Gorakshah Paninishcha Patanjalihi Shankaro Madhvanimbarkau Shri Ramanuja Vallabhau.
Shreya, can you read it? In Indians. Vedika, can you read it?
Yolo la lota sautanyaha puruvallu varasthata Navanna rala varasa kandasya vasavasaraha.
Jhule la lota chaitanyas tiruvallu varasthata Nayanma rala varascha kambascha vasaveshwaraha. देवलो रविदासश्च कबीरो गुरुनानकः नरसिस्तुलसीदासो दशमेशो दृढव्रतः श्रीमच्छंकरदेवश्च बन्धुसायणमाधवौ ज्ञानेश्वरस्तुकारामो रामदासः पुरन्दरः विरसा सहजानन्दो रामानन्दस्तथा महान् वितरन्तु सदैवैते दैवीं सद्गुणसंपदम्।
So these are the shlokas that we have covered till now. So along with the personalities that you read from the book, just try to practice the shlokas. So the music or the bhava behind it, so that you will be able to recollect and you will be able to connect yourself with the personality. So that will have an attraction towards reading that. So this is what we have planned. Okay, so just I will give you some of the tips on how you prepare. I mean, we have given you the earlier, just a reminder on those so that you can prepare the next presentations in a better way. So as I said, the presentations that you prepare, the PPTs that you add should have a picture so that it can grasp, so that the people will be able to recognize on whom the presentation is going on. It should have a smaller or a bigger picture. It can, the whole slide can be a complete picture representing it, or along with some a smaller picture with some quotes or some words or something related to that personality, so that people who is attending or who is listening or who is seeing that presentation will be able to quickly attach with that presentation or the personality. So when they listen to your words or listen to your sayings, they can be able to correlate with that picture and the words that are there in the presentation. So again, to add to make them listen to you rather than reading the PPT, you should have a word or a phrase in the PPT. It should not be a full sentence, so that they listen to you more attentively than trying to read it. So what happens is they'll try to read the sentences and then the PPT and listen lesser to you. So it is better always to have a full or a word or a phrase rather than a complete sentence, so that they will be able to listen to you and anything that you add, because the reading will take a longer time. If the sentence is there, if they say sentences of 10 words, the time the person takes to read it, because he has to connect to it first what is written, then listening to you. If they are listening to you, they will be in the spending or listening more, the double the word you tell, the half they will listen or the half they will read. So it is always better to make them listen to you. Just connecting the PPT should be just making them connect to you or what the current topic on that. So always try to add more the saying than the reading for that. So and the more making them more attractive, the presenting with a different background, maybe the single color or a multicolor or with some designs. When you type something or when you put a picture and some text, the PowerPoint itself will present you some of the design ideas. You can take one of the ideas which will suit the current topic that you are handling. So that will add more catchy to the listeners or the viewers. Rupeshwar has just joined. Rupeshwar, are you ready with your presentation?
No, sir.
Okay, fine, no problem. So we'll have it in the next week. Okay, so be ready by that time. And to the people who have not yet given your recordings, either audio or video, try to make it in the next week. Okay. So whoever has already presented the recordings, we have already sent the recordings. For those only, I will give you the next list of personalities. So others who have not presented the current one, and they can present the current one. So who have already sent their recordings, they can choose one of the new personalities and send their recordings in the next week. So with that, is there anything that you want to ask about exam or about any of the personalities that are presented today? Anyone have a query? And whoever has not yet registered through the Google form, please go ahead and register for the exam through the Google form. So I will put those Google form once again in the group. If you have lost the earlier link, go through that link and then present and register yourself. So whoever has already registered, you can tell others to register or follow up with your friends and family who are in that age range of 7th to 11th. So earlier we had said only it is applicable for students who are there in 8th to 11th. So now because the Bal Bharati who are the 12th year or 7th standard is falling in the Bal Bharati as well as in Kishore Bharati because of the age range. So whoever is in the 7th standard, but they have crossed the 12 years of age or the 12 years of age, they can also register for this Kishore Bharati exam. So once I will post them, you can register whoever has not registered. So any queries from anyone?
No, sir.
Okay, fine. So if there are no queries and about the exam or the personalities, we will conclude today's session with Shanti Mantra. Yeah, anyone has a query? Yes, Anvi?
Sir, how much is the total marks for the exam?
That will be, last year we had around 50. The same will continue or there may be a change. We will let you know the details of that on that. Okay, we'll come to know about that in another 1 or 2 weeks. The pattern may change from last year. So the last year was the first online one. So that was an experiment done. So this time it is the second year. So any improvements can happen on that. Last year we had a mix of 1 marks questions, 3 marks questions and 5 marks questions. So the similar thing may happen or slightly written one will have a more, contribution to it, your marks. Is clear, Sunny?
Yes, sir.
All right, fine. So go through the book also apart from what we are doing it in the session. So you can... I will send you the link of the YouTube also. So whatever the sessions that we had till now, we have uploaded into YouTube. I will send that. So you can listen to that and as well as read the book for preparing the exam. We will conclude today's session with the Shanti Mantra from Srishti. Srishti?
Yes, sir. Sarve bhavantu sukhinaha. सर्वे सन्तु निरामयाः सर्वे भद्राणि पश्यन्तु मा कश्चित् दुःखभाग् भवेत् ॐ शान्ति शान्ति शान्तिः
धन्यवादः धन्यवादः